My name is Brian Fletcher, and I'm the strength and conditioning coach at Adrenaline Training Center in London, Ontario. His last few fights, he's been in amazing condition. He's actually gotten stronger with each round going on. A lot of that has to do with the methodology that we use here today, so that we can get him conditioned to last the 5 minutes in the round. My job, as I see it with the circuits, is to get his heart rate up as high as possible and keep it there as long as possible. That way, when he's inside the cage, he'll always be able to pay back his oxygen debt. I'm a big believer in a lot of explosive activities in getting ready for a fight, because that's exactly what, if you watch in the ring, what's happening. It's explode, react, explode, react. You want to make sure that they get as many explosive movements in a shorter period of time as possible, so their body's capable, when they're fatigued, still develop that kind of power that they need to win a fight.
Just finished my strength and conditioning. I gotta be back in an hour and a half to do my boxing and pad work, and then depending on how I feel after that, I might get a couple rounds of sparring in later. It's a good thing I live close to the gym though. I only live it's a 5 minute drive from my house to the gym, so I'm there and back 3 times a day every day. I work on conditioning mainly, as opposed to trying to think of different game plans and all these different strategies and stuff. When you get a short camp, you just go right to it and get your body ready. So it's kind of why I'm all scruffy right now. Just let myself get all good on the inside and ready to go, and a little dusty on the outside, and then when it's time to perform, I get all shaved and prettied up. It's just kind of like a race car. Get that nice paint job on and get it all shined up, and then you're just ready to perform. Kind of thinking of myself the same way. I'd rather just pay attention to my family and my life and get myself just ready to fight. I don't like talking about my opponents. And, being a fighting sport, people always want you to say like mean things and act tough, and it's just not my character. I don't trash talk anybody. I don't make predictions that I'm gonna smash his face in. I don't like that kind of talk. Even if one of my fans wrote on my wall or something, hey, you're gonna break his nose and kill that fucker, I'd probably tell the fan, don't say that about the guy. You don't know him. He's just doing his job, same as I am. So I'd rather talk about my family and things like that as opposed to talking about how bad I'm gonna beat somebody up or something like that. It's not the way I like to roll, basically.
Kind of an interesting story. He asked out my really good friend.
I was at a bar with a couple of my friends, and there was a waitress there that I had talked to a few times. So I decided to ask her on a date. It was the first girl I've ever asked on a date in my entire life. I've never asked a girl on a date ever.
He asked her out on a date, but she was actually dating someone, and she just happens to say,
she had a friend, she thought it would be perfect for me. So,
I'm dating someone, but I've got this friend who you'd be perfect for.
Quite a few years ago, so MSN was pretty cool back then. So she gave us each other's MSNs, and then one day I seen that she added me to MSN, so I was like, oh, since she added me, I guess I should say hello.
We just started talking on the computer, and I was just like,
We had a couple conversations, and then it just happened that night that we were both going to the same place, so we ended up meeting up.
And then we met at a bar that evening.
She's with her friends, I was with my friends.
I was just like, he's like, yeah, I'm a fighter, and tried to sway me, and it didn't work.
We got talking, and then
he would leave notes on my car. He would come see me at work.
It just turned out that she worked, or actually, I worked right on the corner from her house.
Pretty much, kind of stopped me a little bit.
Kind of went from there. It was an up and down.
I told him he was too old for me, and it wasn't gonna work.
I think she was 22 at the time, and I was a week away from my 30th birthday. So I had to break it to her how old I was. I think she was a university girl, so they kind of scared her a little bit that I was 30 years old and she was only 22.
But then, girl,
she couldn't resist the charm, so.
It's not a fairy tale, but it's our fairy tale.
Sooner or later, I reeled her in. I'm an old guy from a small town, so I just didn't expect it to come true. I'm from Dresden, Ontario, 2,600 people, right? I grew up in a town where everybody's a farmer. I grew up in a pretty poor family. My mom couldn't work. She had a bad heart. My dad worked in a factory.
Down in the city, and the sun shines on.
continue to make it. That's a really big deal for my family. And part of being in the UFC was so my family could enjoy the moment with me. That's why I really want to fight in Ontario or in Montreal sometime, somewhere close, my family can experience me fighting in the UFC live, because I do it just as much for me as I did for them.
Like, everybody calls me Mom, or Ma Bell, or Grandma Bell. Well, he's always told me that. He always says, I'm going to get in that UFC. You want it bad enough, you'll get it. I'm happy for it. He's, you know, he's doing his thing. Oh, I was excited for it. I really didn't know what to say, because I was almost in a loss for words when he called me. And my husband got the phone and he says, I think she's in shock. Because I was just sitting there smiling and nothing come out. And I'm just, yeah, I'm so happy for him. And I told him, I says, and what are you going to do now? He goes, I'm going to fight. Chris, he was always saying he was going to be the best in whatever he tried to do. And I remember he had lost, he was trying for a belt, I can't remember which one it was, and he felt so bad, and I says, oh, don't feel bad about it. I says, everybody wins things and everybody loses things, but it's a learning experience. You almost have to cherish the losses of things in order to appreciate the good that you have when you have good. We just grew up that way. We got along pretty well with everybody. And I can't think of anybody that didn't like Chris.
He actually tells it best.
I was leaving for about a month to go to Las Vegas, and I remember being on the plane and being like, wow, I miss that girl. I didn't want to leave her, so I was like, I think I'm going to propose to her when I get back. And then,
I guess he's planning to propose to me in Cuba. My favorite thing in the world is dolphins. And my dream is always to swim with them. It's the only thing I ever wanted to do.
I was prepared to do it as soon as she came out of the water. I had planned on proposing, you know, the ring right there. She was with the dolphins. It was her dream come true. And I was just going to be standing there with this ring as soon as she came out of the water.
I was miserable in Cuba. I just wanted to go to the bar and have a couple glasses of wine with our friends that we had met there. And I was grumpy. I was kind of sad and kind of grumpy. So
we had the dolphin trip was booked for the day before we were going home. So the night before the dolphin swim, she was just miserable. This is about 9 o'clock at night. She's been grumpy all day, just not really like wanting to talk to me. And I thought I did something wrong, so I finally asked her what was wrong.
And unfortunately, it just happened to be the day that my grandfather passed away. So I was, and he was like my father.
Passed away. I knew they were really close, so I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to propose to her on the same day that her grandpa had passed away, and she was going to be upset on it. So I looked at the clock, and I had about 2.5 hours. To try and find a new way to propose.
He kept trying to get me to go places. He's like, do you want to go for a walk? And I was like, no.
I don't want to go to the beach. It's dark outside. What do I want to go to the beach for? Let's go up to the terrace and look out at the really nice part of the resort.
Like, no, I'm good. He's like, well, I have to go back to the room and get some bug spray. Do you want to come with me? I'm like,
okay, go get it by yourself. She just gave me attitude, like the worst attitude all day. And then finally I seen this little gazebo thing by the pool. And I just kind of said, go over here. I'll talk to you for a minute.
And I just started bawling because we had been kind of arguing all that day because I was grumpy, and I was just like, I was thinking he was going to break up with me, and I was just crying, and then he just kind of...
I was so nervous. I didn't get down on one knee. I think I put the ring on the wrong hand.
He pulled out the ring and he said, he's like, oh yeah, he said, we came here to make your dream come true, swim with dolphins. I was wondering if you'd make mine come true and marry me.
You know, she didn't even answer yes. She just kept going, really? You serious? Really?
It was so sweet. So then I started crying even harder.
I don't remember her ever saying yes, actually. She took the ring.
I don't even think I said yes. I was just, are you for real? Are you really? Is this happening?
The whole resort had already known because I was a proposed. I had shown, I think, everybody on the resort the ring that a whole week long. So.
And then that was it. So I kind of ruined it.
Yeah, it wasn't the most thought out. The way it ended up happening, but you know, it's our own little story. So.
Chris had been a while without an actual trainer. He approached me. I worked with him a couple times, and I realized what a natural athlete he was. And right away, there was some chemistry there. The guy works as hard as he wanted to work. And the neat thing about Chris is we work on really orthodox striking. but that's not Chris's style. Chris will work on the straight punching. The way he delivers his shots, it's his own game.
Talking what to do. When I spar, I just do my own thing and I have fun and I beat people up sparring. And then when I fight, I get all stiff because I try and listen to somebody else. And on the way to the cage, the dealer looked at me and said, "Be yourself." And I just stopped and was like, "Oh, wow." And I went in there and I just felt so much looser and I had fun. And I started enjoying the sport again and I haven't lost since. So it's made a huge difference.
Oh, the wedding day.
Poured. Rain, downpour, like pour like you wouldn't imagine.
I actually had to pull over on the way to Hamilton twice because I couldn't even see. I just remember driving there and going, "Really, God? Really? This is what you give me today? Really?" It was one of the worst rain downs I've ever seen.
And then as soon as I got ready to walk out, it stopped. We got married just outside of Hamilton in Vineland,
beautiful winery, very old, all stone walls and everything. We got married in a small chapel.
So it was really great. It was just a small ceremony, 65 people.
Everything was just real personal in the way I like.
Everyone went on a wine tour and taste, and then we just had a great dinner with our good friends and family.
It all worked out perfect.
You're bored. You keep looking up recipes online.
I'm bored. Clean the house. Clean up after you. Take care of her full time. This is our daughter. Her name's Avery Bell. She is 16 weeks.
She's changed my life like instantly. You hear people talk about, "Oh, you know what it's like to have your own kid." Every time you have your own kid, you'll see, and it's true. You can't explain to people what it feels like to be a parent. So, if a kid pops out, and then your whole life changes in an instant.
Yeah, she's
a kid. Actually, a lot of people tell you stuff like, "Oh, I gotta fight for my kids." She's my inspiration. I don't want to go train because I don't want to leave her. I have a hard time walking out the door. I think it makes me weaker. I try and use that motivation like other people say, but I just want to stay at home with my daughter. She makes me soft.
Yeah, she's definitely changed him. He's an awesome dad. Even when he went to UFC, he had such a hard time leaving. He didn't even want to go. And then he's sending me videos to play to her because he didn't want her to forget him.
I made a 15-20 second video of me talking to her.
Avery, Avery Bell, Papa, hey Princess Tutu, Papa loves you, see you soon. Bye, baby.
The way I would talk to her so that she could play to her every day. So I was scared that at her age, she was only 6 weeks old, that when I got home, she wouldn't know who it was. I didn't want her to forget me.
Thanks. My note. Can you get me? Oh, there we go. You spit up all over yourself. Yeah, right down your shirt.
She's going to be a golfer, a pro golfer, and a nun.
Yeah.
Is that her combination?
I kind of thought Mom would let her be a lesbian so she didn't have to hear a boy. She didn't know. So I think she would get that.
Yeah, you think that's funny too, yeah. Don't you?
We'll be right back.
into my fight in the UFC, it was a lot different than other fights because I had no pressure on me anymore. When I fought Rich Clemente, I was frozen going into that fight because my whole career relied on that fight. Yeah, I almost retired. I was pretty much in retirement before they offered me the delayed fight. I just put all my effort into getting in shape and being ready for the fight. I went in there and I ended up knocking him out. But then after that, I was just like, wow, I have a chance to get the UFC again here. So, you know, everything mattered so much. Every fight I went into was like, you have to win or you're not going to get a chance. It's going to be over. Especially when I fought Rich Clemente. I'd already beaten Goulet and three other guys. And I was like, well, if I lose this fight, I'm never going to the UFC because I don't have it in me to do another six-fight run and try and get there at 40 years old, you know. Everything was on the line for that fight. You know, I went in there, I was real slow if you watch the fight. I didn't really fight back for much. I couldn't get going at first. After I beat him and I got called to the UFC, I was just like, oh shit, I'm here. I made it.
It was a little unbelievable because he came in and he just started crying while he said it. And it was just kind of like, you know, he's the fighter and he does all the training, but I always feel like it's something we both worked for. The greatest news you could ask for, like almost as much as our baby girl. Like, it was just like, wow, you know, like you've worked so hard. Like, nobody understands how much work they put into it and how much you give up. And you give up your life, you give up your family, you give up things financially. You know, people think, oh, you're on TV, you're rich. Well, no, that's not the case. But it's all for a goal, you know, and he reached that goal.
I did it. So now I can just be myself and even have fun. I went in the second round, and if you see them watch the fight, you'll see him go, what? What? I was going, I like you, man. I really like you like that. I was just having fun. After my song, I got to the cage, I went to the center, and I laid down, and I put my hands behind my head, and I crossed my feet on the ground in the middle of the UFC octagon, and I just looked around. And I looked up at the people in the crowd, I looked up at the lights, and I just said, man, the UFC, this is pretty cool. And I just laid there until my opponent got in the ring, just enjoyed the experience. There was no stress on me at all. I didn't even think about winning or losing. I just wanted to enjoy the moment. It was an amazing experience, and I'm so thankful that my dream got to come true and I lived it. I came to fight, I put on a show. That's all I want the world to see. My biggest motivation is my family.
Not many people can say that they've watched someone's dreams come true, and I've had the opportunity to do that, so that's a pretty special place to be. It's an important part of our relationship.
You only have one life, you know. We're putting our whole lives into this one sport. When you get a fight coming up, you dedicate 24 hours a day for like 10 weeks into that job. You know, you want to do that for something that's not fun. Some guys stress themselves out too much on winning and losing, and losers find an excuse, but winners find a way.